Thank you. It's a great pleasure and a great honor for me to be here, at least virtually. And okay, now it works. So I will speak about these non-local minimal surfaces. Roughly speaking, the topic I will discuss is the minimization problem of an energy functional that deals with pointwise interactions between a given set and its complement. And the main idea is that the classical surface tension may be seen somehow as an approximation of a more complex structure arising from long-range pointwise interactions. And the situation created by this type of far away or remote interactions is that there are non-local phase transitions and capillarity theories that pop up and produce some, I would say, interesting and new effects due to the special feature of the fact that far away points can communicate. And the contribution coming from far can actually produce significant differences with respect to the classical cases. And for instance, I will speak about this new phenomenon in non-local minimal surfaces that we call stickiness, in the sense that while classical minimal surfaces typically cross the boundary transversally, at least in convex settings, conversely, the non-local minimal surfaces have the very strong tendency to stick at the boundary, and we will see why and what the consequences of this phenomenon are. So the energy function I will look at was introduced by Caffarelli, Roggioffre, and Savin. And it's basically the localized version of the interaction between E and its complement. So basically, I'm writing here all the possible interactions that involve a given set E and its complement, taking into account the fact that at least one interaction lies in a given reference domain omega. So the interaction that one considers is rotational and translational invariant and decays polynomially at infinity. So the prototype is given by this kernel here, 1 over x minus y to the n plus s. And more general situations can be taken into account, but for the sake of simplicity, I will look specifically at this type of kernel. This was actually the specific case that was considered in the original paper by Caffarelli, Roggioffre, and Savin. And for me, S will be a parameter from 0 to 1. So there are many reasons for which one should study this kind of problems, but I think a cute one comes from an application. So in principle, as Francesco knows, computing perimeters is very hard. And my feeling is that it's not hard because one has to learn a difficult technology. Well, that's also part of the thing, but the reason for which one has to learn difficult technology is because in itself, computing perimeter is hard. And for instance, if you have a square, say, this is a square of side 1, and you digitalize this image, so you have a computer with pixels and you digitalize the image, well, the square is going to be replaced by this this tilted salt pattern. And so if you ask the computer to calculate the perimeter of this object, is not going to be 4, that is the original original square perimeter, but it's going to be 4√2. No matter how good your computer is and no matter how fine your pixelization is. So you end up producing a significant error in spite of the money that you can spend to buy a new computer or a better computer. Vice versa, non-local perimeter provides a much more flexible technology because the error that you compute in each pixel just comes from scaling, so it's of order epsilon to the 2 minus s, if epsilon is the size of the pixel. The number of pixels involved in the computation is 1 over epsilon, so the total error is order of epsilon to the power 1 minus s. So since s is less than 1, in this way, 1 produces a small error, and so in general, non-local perimeters are more feasible, or at least more flexible, in a number of applications because the errors are somehow more stable or in better control. So in the first paper by Kafaili, Rojofre, and Savin, there are a huge number of results, but just let me recall some. There is an existing theorem, so minimizers exist for given data outside a reasonable domain omega. There is a maximum principle, which implies that the hyperplanes are minimizers. There is the first step in the regularity theory in the sense that they prove that minimizers are C1 alpha, are locally C1 alpha, except possibly a closed set with dimension less or equal than n minus 2. Another important thing that is proved in the paper is that minimizers satisfy a suitable Euler-Lagrange equation that can be considered like a vanishing non-local mean curvature equation that I wrote here. In a sense, the proportion of the set E is perfectly balanced by the proportion of the complement in a weighted fashion, weighted with respect to the kernel producing the perimeter. Now, the regularity theory can be actually improved in the sense that together with Ovidiu Savin, we proved that cones in dimension 2 are regular. This implies in particular that minimizers are C1 alpha except possibly a set of Hausdorff dimension n minus 3. This is slightly better than the previous one because in the Kafaili-Rojofre-Savin paper we had n minus 2. So somehow you improve your regularity by one dimension in this way. I would like to give a sketch, I would not say of the proof of the result with Ovidiu, but why one should somehow think of the proof of this result. So the first difficulty that one has in trying to prove a theorem like that is that in the classical case, dimension two is easy because if you have a corner, you can just cut the corner and reduce the length. But in higher dimension, whenever you cut and paste, you produce errors that have to be globally taken into account. So cut and paste is tricky and one has to avoid it. Instead of that, it would be more convenient to look at flows and diffeomorphisms. So let me give a proof that there are no corners for geodesics in R2 that does not use explicitly a cut and paste argument. So suppose that you have a corner. Well, I know I could just do the cut, but I don't want to do the cut. I do this, so I fix a point here. For instance, the origin is the edge of the corner, and then I take the point with coordinates 1, 1, and I want to move the origin towards the point 1, 1. So I want to do this movement here with a diffeomorphism. And then I want to obtain again the original corner outside the ball of radius r or r plus 1. So if I do that, basically I want to move the corner here and I obtain a new set which is done like this. Then I do my computation, right? So this is my new set. Did I gain or did I lose making this gain? Well, I gained a bit because I'm replacing r plus one with the square root of r squared plus one. And basically the difference between these two objects is always in your favor. So the idea of the proof with Ovidio is exactly to follow this strategy for the non-local perimeter. Of course, the strategy has to be a little bit adapted because this is a very simplified situation in which you already know your corner and you already know where to go. The idea is that you have somehow to average the directions in which you make these initial translations and take care of the contribution of the energy. But somehow what I want to say is that this simple idea can be made work in a much more delicate setting. So one, of course, would like to extend the regularity theory in higher dimensions. So let me mention a result that we did with Alessio a long time ago. It's a Bernstein type result. It's actually an abstract form of a Bernstein result in the spirit of a classical result by De Giorgi. So the Bernstein problem is to decide whether or not minimal graphs, global minimal graphs, happen to be affine. And the answer we give is positive, provided that the S-minimal surfaces are regular in one dimension less. So somehow the abstract version of Bernstein is that if you have an S-minimal graph in Rn plus one and S-minimal surfaces are smooth in dimension n, then the graph that you have is actually a hyperplane. So this in particular gives the regularity of minimal graphs in dimension three. The idea would be now to try to recover the full regularity theory in higher dimensions. This is quite tricky, and I think it's still an open problem. I would say one of the most important open problems in the topic. So far, I would say the only cases that are better understood are the limit cases. So there is this classical result due to Burguin, Brezis, Mironescu, and later extended by several people. That is somehow this idea that the limit of the S perimeter, if suitably rescaled, converges to the classical perimeter as S goes to one, up to normalizing constants. Now, the interesting thing of this feature is that it carries over to the minimizers in the sense that when S is close to one, non-local minimal surfaces behave as good as the classical counterparts. So for instance, if E is a minimizer, then its boundary is locally C1 alpha, except in a closed set of dimension less or equal than n minus 8. At the moment, I think that it's still open to know even the possibility of a counterexample. So when I say that there is a possibly singular set, I'm somehow pessimistic because there is no example so far of singular sets. The other concept that is somehow sufficiently well understood is the limit as S goes to zero. This started in terms of the minimum of a Gagliardo semi-norm with a paper by Mazia and Shaposhnikova, and was later applied to the case of the non-local perimeter by Alessio and Serena Di Pierro, Gian Piero Palatucci, and myself. So the interesting thing of this object is that when S goes to zero, the S perimeter somehow recovers the Lebesgue measure. This is something that appeared already in the Mazia-Shaposhnikova paper. But in this case, the fact that we localize the S perimeter in the domain actually produce somehow an interaction between the local structure of the measure of the set E inside the domain and the measure of its complement, with the global structure that is inherited by the behavior of the non-local minimal surface at infinity. So in this setting, we introduce this interesting parameter alpha E, which will also play a role in the following part of the talk, which is basically taking into account the non-local contribution at infinity of the set E. So the larger E at infinity, the larger this parameter alpha E. And now, interesting, the limit as S go to zero of the S perimeter is precisely a convex combination between the area of E in omega and the area of the complement of E in omega. And this convex parameter that does the interpolation is exactly the memory of the set at infinity. So it's an interplay between what happens inside omega and what happens at infinity. So let me go back to the main topic that I was mentioning, this stickiness property. So we don't want to give a precise definition of stickiness, but rather somehow to underline a phenomenon. So the stickiness property is something that occurs whenever, somehow unexpectedly, the S minimal set ends up sticking at the boundary. So my feeling is this, that while the classical mean curvature equation is a local equation, the non-local mean curvature equation is somehow much harder for a set to fulfill, because not only the set has to adjust locally to this equation, but it also has to take into account the energy coming from infinity. And sometimes all these constraints are too heavy for the set, and the set prefers to crash against the boundary rather than fulfilling such a difficult equation. And this is exactly, for instance, what happens in many cases. For instance, this is an example. You can take K delta, that is just the half ball of radius one plus delta outside the ball of radius one. Okay. And then the result that we obtained with Ovidio and Serena is that when delta is small enough, the set minimizing this configuration is K delta itself. So basically the minimizer of this object is the empty set inside the ball. This is maybe surprising, considering that the classical case would be just the bottom half ball. So when delta is sufficiently small, in this case, rather than having a half ball, one gets the empty set. So another interesting example is what happens when you have a cylinder and you have the data of the cylinder that are far apart from one from the other. So for instance, rather than reading the theorem, I think it's more interesting just to look at the picture. Then the theorem is actually the quantification of the picture. But the picture would be like this. So you have a cylinder and you prescribe values on the right that are given by a horizontal line of height M. And on the left, you have a horizontal line of constantly equal to minus M. So on the left, you have this set here. On the right, you have this set here. Now what happens is that the minimizer inside is an object, which we don't know much about it, but it's going to be a graph that sticks vertically at the boundary with a significant amount. So for instance, if M is large, the stickiness phenomenon is like M to the beta with an explicit and optimal exponent beta. So the larger the M, the larger the stickiness is. Again, this is completely in contradiction with the classical case, because the classical case in this situation would just produce a straight line joining these two endpoints. Oh, let me mention that the pictures I'm showing are just drawing done to help the intuition. But actually recently, Nocetto and his collaborators ran some very interesting and beautiful simulations to produce pictures like that with the data. And I would say more or less, I think that the pictures I'm showing are very similar to the one that Nocetto produced numerically, with the only exception that I'm keen to emphasize the stickiness phenomenon. So whenever you see a picture drawn by me, well, I would say keep in mind that the stickiness phenomenon is not quantitatively as evident as I drew it. So of course, M to the beta is going to be much smaller than M, so that the stickiness part here could be not accurate from the realistic point of view. But nevertheless, I think the idea is more or less fine as I drew it. Other phenomena, for instance, happen when S go to zero. So roughly speaking, the stickiness phenomenon is due to the energy at infinity, meaning that the smaller the parameter S is, the more relevant the contribution from far away happens to be. So one way to detect stickiness is also to consider the case of small s. Again, this is a situation that we described. You can take into account, for instance, a sector at infinity. You take a normal sector, an orthogonal sector at infinity, and you send S to zero. Then what you see is that your set will be pushed towards the boundary when S becomes smaller and smaller. And this you can guess it because on the one side locally, you will have more complement than the set. So if you have a point here nearby, a curve of this type will have more complement of the set rather than the set itself. But at infinity, the situation is opposite. You have much more at infinity you have much more complement of the set than the set itself. So the two things have to compensate. So here you have more set, right? Because locally you have a parabola, so whatever is outside the parabola is giving you the set. So locally you have more set than the complement, but at infinity you have more complement than the set. And so these two things balance, but balance till S becomes too small for allowing this compensation. So the theorem is that there exists a precise threshold as zero below which the minimal set inside the ball is empty, because the set cannot compensate what happens at infinity anymore. And this happens for a precise threshold as zero. Okay, among the examples of stickiness, my favorite one is here. So again, let me skip the technical part, but let me go at the picture. So the picture is that, let's see if I have the simulation. So let's look at what happened in the movie. So if you start with the half plane, so I'm minimizing here inside the strip minus one, one, And if I start with the half plane outside the strip, I'm going to have a half plane inside. This was one of the first results I mentioned by Caffarelli, Roggioffre, and Savi. But then what happens if I perturb this picture? For instance, I put two small bumps on the side. Well, the minimizer is going to bend up for the same reason, because near here, I see more complement than the set, but here I get some more set because of these two masses far away. Then if I keep moving the bumps on the side, my set will also grow up. So I keep enlarging it. So my set will also grow up. And the interesting part is that the set will completely stick at the vertical portions of the boundary for a quantity that, again, you can explicitly compute. Again, this is completely in disagreement with the classical case, because the classical case, no matter what the bumps do, will just be a horizontal straight line passing through minus one and one. The proof of this is, I would say, quite difficult. The idea is that one has to produce an explicit barrier for that. And the barrier is constructed in an iterative way. So the first trick is to put a corner near the origin. Well, if I put a corner near the origin, I produce a huge positive curvature at the origin itself. Then I start bending a bit my barrier, like here and then here and then here. Now, the good thing of the non-local world is that the non-local world remembers what you have done previously. So whenever I compute the non-local curvature inside, I still feel the strong kick that I put initially. So I have somehow, I can allow myself some room to bend this curve and still maintain positive curvature. And then I have somehow to glue it conveniently with the power of the variable, somehow matching the fractional Laplacian when I get sufficiently horizontally. And then I have to flip this picture to construct a full barrier. But besides technicality, I would like to convince you that in pictures like this, the stickiness phenomenon is somehow unavoidable. Let me try to do a simpler guess. So rather than looking at bumps, I will look at some kind of cones at infinity. And the idea is to prove that you have stickiness because you cannot have anything else. So I will look at the usual suspects of the minimization. So I'm making here this game. I have some kind of cone at infinity, and I look at what happens here. So what can happen? Can you, for instance, expect to have a smooth minimizer like this? Well, you cannot, because this minimizer, or this candidate for the minimization, has a very strong alibi, provided by the fact that when I compute the curvature at the minimum point, I'm going to see more set than the complement, just because the top and the bottom would simplify with respect to the horizontal line, but I have still more Bruce set from one part to the other. So this suspect has to be ruled out. Another possibility that one can say, okay, you don't have a smooth curve coming down, you have oscillations. But oscillations are as bad as before because you can still take the minimum, and the same argument as before would rule out a picture like this. At this minimum point, I see much more set than the complement. Then you can say, okay, I understand that a minimum point is bad. I just produce a maximum, but I produce a maximum in a continuous way, in a way in which I don't stick at the boundary. Is this possible? Well, not really, because if you now take a point very close to the boundary, well, let's say at the boundary for simplicity, well, you will see here that you still see much more set than the complement, because suppose now that this red line is basically in the limit, you make it this coincident with the blue part, then again, I see much more blue set than white set. Of course, you cannot expect the non-local minimizer to agree even with the classical minimizer, because in this case, it would be just a horizontal straight line. But again, I compare with the horizontal straight line itself, and I see that I have much more set than its complement. So I have ruled out all the possibilities. I have to accept that there is a boundary discontinuity, and again, the boundary discontinuity cannot go down because it would produce a minimum, and I already know that minima are forbidden, so it has to go up. Here it is. And now, as you see, the idea of computing the curvature here does not produce any contradiction, because when I compute the curvature here, I have a local situation in which I see more complement than the set, and the global situation in which I recover the set at infinity. So this picture does not produce any contradiction. So this is the only suspect that does not have an alibi, and this strongly suggests that he is the culprit. And in fact, this is exactly the picture that one would get from the barrier. So about the important role produced by contributions at infinity, I would like to remember some results obtained with Claudia Bucur and Luca Lombardini that somehow extend the problem I set initially with the quadrant. Actually, this is something that Francesco asked me some time ago. So the quadrant looked very special, very convenient for the computation, but what's special about the quadrant after all? Well, the idea is that one can do a more sophisticated class of examples by taking into account the parameter alpha that arose in the paper with Alessio. So the idea is that parameter alpha tells me how large, in average, I am at infinity. And so if the width at infinity is strictly less or strictly large than the width of the half plane, then stickiness will occur. So suppose, for instance, that the alpha of your minimizer is less than the alpha of the half space. The minimizer at infinity is given by the exterior datum, so it's fixed. But then if half of the exterior datum, that is half of the minimizer, is less than half of the half plane, there exists an S0 such that the minimizer will be empty inside the domain. Okay, so I don't know if I'm covering, yes. Okay. Will be empty inside the domain. So I think it's nice that that parameter alpha that surfaced like a convex interpolation parameter between the measure of the set and the complement of the measure of the set as a limit case is actually exactly the precise threshold providing the stickiness for small s in a very general situation. So I think that after all this analysis, there are at least three questions that remain to be addressed. One is, how regular are the non-local minimal surfaces coming from inside the domain? So all these examples of stickiness tell me that non-local minimal graphs tend to have boundary discontinuities. I can push to have a more accurate description of the regularity theory in the interior, but as the boundary regularity goes, there is no way to have anything better than discontinuity. So jump discontinuities are allowed. So you can be continuous from one side, continuous from the other, but the jump discontinuities is exactly one of the special features offered by the stickiness phenomenon. Nevertheless, can we say something more about the surface coming from inside the domain? The other question is a bit related. If you remember, there was at some point a picture in which I was computing the curvature of the minimizer at the boundary, but I couldn't really say at the boundary. So I said, well, I put my point very close to the boundary and then I take the limit. But it would be desirable to say whether or not the Euler-Lagrange equation, the vanishing non-local mean curvature equation, is satisfied precisely at boundary point, not just trying to take limits or whatsoever. And the third question is, how typical the stickiness phenomenon is. So up to now, I gave a number of examples, but maybe you can think, okay, you are just lucky that you found these examples, but maybe in most of the situations, stickiness does not exist. I think it's interesting that the answer of these three questions are somehow coming together. This is a recent result by Serena Di Pierro, Ovidio Sari, and myself. And let's see. So first of all, for the first question, the regularity, the boundary regularity coming from inside provides somehow a dichotomy. So the idea is that continuity implies differentiability. So in general, we know that we can have discontinuities caused by the stickiness phenomenon, but nevertheless, suppose for instance that you have a non-local minimal graph in the plane that is smooth, the datum outside is smooth for simplicity, then you have a precise dichotomy. So either you have a boundary discontinuity, so the limit from one side does not agree with the limit from outside. But in this case, you also have that the derivative blows up at the boundary, or you have continuity. So for some reason, the datum outside coincides with the minimizer inside. But in this case, you are automatically C1 alpha. And actually, it's very important, but the alpha is, I don't know if it's important that it's 1 plus S over 2, but it's a sufficiently large alpha. So it's C1 alpha with a good alpha, let's say. We will see why it's important later on. Okay, so this is why I say continuity implies differentiability. Because once you are in the second part of the dichotomy and you are continuous, then you are automatically C1 and so differentiable. So again, it's interesting that this dichotomy is really a nonlinear effect. It's really coming from the fact that we have, after all, a nonlinear equation, a geometric equation of nonlinear type that we have to take into account. because, for instance, for linear equations, the boundary regularity is completely different. This is something that has been widely investigated by Serra and Rossoton. There are also a number of papers by Bogdan, by Gerd Grubb. So I would say, to make a long story short, the behavior of linear equation is that you have always at least Hölder continuity at the boundary. So the situation for nonlinear equations is completely different, because here, for instance, for the non-local minimal surfaces, you don't have even continuity, so not even the Hölder exponent is not even reachable. But once you have continuity, you are automatically C1 alpha. So it's really a different scenario. Another thing that is somehow thought-provoking is that the stickiness phenomenon can be seen in light of the dichotomy as a butterfly effect, in the sense that if you think about the perturbation from the half plane, an arbitrary small perturbation of flat data produce a boundary discontinuity, which also produces an infinite derivative at the boundary. So all in all, an arbitrary small perturbation produce an infinite derivative straight away. So you start from zero derivative, you perturb it a bit far away, and you produce an infinite derivative with an arbitrary small perturbation. So this is why I'm calling this type of phenomena a butterfly effect. A small perturbation far away produces an infinite derivative. Okay, another remark is that it's true that the boundary regularity is in general poor because you can have discontinuities, but think about the problem in a geometric way, so that instead of thinking about the regularity of the graph, which can be discontinuous, you think about the regularity of the curve describing the boundary, then this curve is always C1 alpha, C1, 1 plus S over 2. This independently on the possible boundary discontinuity, in the sense that if it's continuous at the boundary, it's really a graph of a C1 alpha function, okay? But even when it is discontinuous, the vertical derivative, the vertical stickiness, the infinite derivative, actually says that you have a C1 alpha detaching from the vertical line. This was proved by Daniela De Silva and Ovidio Savi. So if you put all these ingredients together, you are saying that the part of the curve near the boundary is actually the inverse function, or it's the inverse of a C1 alpha function. So again, the regularity in terms of the geometric regularity in terms of the geometric object is still sufficiently high, in spite the graph itself is discontinuous. Okay, so I was mentioning before that the exponent that we get here, C1 alpha, but alpha is 1 plus S over 2. We don't know whether 1 plus S over 2 is optimal or not, but we know that 1 plus S over 2 is sufficiently large, in the sense that you can write the non-local mean curvature for graphs in a very simple form. And this was actually written maybe the first time in a paper with Alessio and Begonia Barrios, when we proved that C1 regularity was actually enough, or Lipschitz regularity was actually enough to obtain C infinity regularity. But so here, what I want to mention is that once you write the non-local mean curvature in this form, you see that the non-local mean curvature is an operator of degree 1 plus s in a sense, because you are, if you look at it just dimensionally, the dy will simplify with 1 and you have 1 plus s remaining. So this is an operator of degree 1 plus s. But now you can see that 1 plus s over 2 is larger than s. So the regularity that you have is C1 alpha with alpha strictly larger than s. And this allows somehow the possibility of passing to the limit. So passing the equation to the limit was actually the second question that we were mentioning before. So the problem was to determine whether or not the Euler-Lagrange equation holds at limit points. And the answer is yes, precisely for the reason I was mentioning before. So since the curve that you have is always of C1 alpha type with alpha equal 1 plus s over 2, which is larger than s, the regularity is sufficiently strong to pass the equation to the limit. So all the points at the boundary that are reachable from points inside satisfy automatically the Euler-Lagrange equation pointwise. Okay, this is conceptually very important because at this point, with this ingredient, we can solve the other question on whether or not the stickiness phenomenon is a generic phenomenon. So what is the idea that to prove that the stickiness is generic, you can just use sliding methods. So you take your favorite situation in which maybe there is no stickiness, then you add the small perturbation and you want to prove that this new situation provides stickiness. And you can say, well, but this is easy because I will use the previous configuration as a barrier for the new one. And I will get a contradiction because whenever I touch, the non-local mean curvature will provide a contradiction to the picture. The fact is that when you want to run this argument, the worst case scenario is precisely that the touching point occurs at the boundary. So the fact that we have proved that the Euler-Lagrange equation is satisfied at the boundary itself allows you to complete this argument. And so in this way, one actually proves that the sliding method produces an extra mass at touching points, even if these touching points lie at the boundary. And so in particular, the stickiness phenomenon is generic in the sense that if you start from a configuration in which there is no stickiness, then an arbitrarily small perturbation compactly supported as far as you want is sufficient to produce stickiness. So basically here I'm trying to make this statement more clear, but so suppose that you have a configuration with some datum u0, which does not produce stickiness, then instead of u0, you take u0 plus t phi, where phi is a smooth compactly supported function. Then for every positive t, you produce a boundary discontinuity. Okay, as you see from all this argument, the trickiest part was to prove the dichotomy. So let me try briefly to explain how the proof of the dichotomy works. The proof is a bit involved, but again, let's look at the usual suspects. What are the people that can show up in a configuration like this? Well, a function can be, roughly speaking, either discontinuous, Lipschitz, Hölder, or smooth, okay? So the idea is that we want to prove that once you are continuous, you are already sufficiently smooth, at least C1 alpha. So our main enemies are the Lipschitz and the Helder guys. So the others are fine because you are either discontinuous or smooth, okay? So to try to eliminate these two possibilities, we look at blow-ups. And the Lipschitz blow-up is easily ruled out because a Lipschitz type of singularity produces a corner, and corners don't satisfy the Euler-Lagrange equation. Okay, you have to take limits, but I mean, it's clear that a corner has too much mass or too little mass. But the Helder continuity is the one that is somehow producing more troubles because the blow-up does not exclude Helder type singularities. I mean, when I do a blow-up of a Helder function, it looks like a vertical corner, which is indistinguishable with respect to a blow-up of a discontinuous function. Basically, I have to distinguish between the good and the bad situation. So the situation I can treat easily is when the function is discontinuous, because then I'm discontinuous. Then there is the intermediate situation in which the function is smooth. The smooth function will produce a flat blow up. Well, in that case, I still have to prove that the original minimizer is smooth. And so for this, one has to do a boundary improvement of flatness combined with the boundary monotonicity formula. And this permits to prove that the initial set is smooth enough. So it's a bit technical, of course, because one needs to beat the boundary regularity of the linear equation. So somehow one has to kill the first order of the linear equation in the approximation. And to this aim, one has to invent a new barrier that proves that the first order approximation in the linearization is actually zero. Still, the Helder case is a little bit tricky to rule out just by waving hands. The idea is that one has to prove that vertical blow-ups can only come from discontinuous, that is already vertical, minimizers. And again, for this, the idea is that one has to compute the non-local mean curvature quite precisely. And for this, one has to slide balls till one touches the set and compute the different contributions and check that if this is the situation, the set would be already trapped in a small enough band. And from that, it follows that it has to be already vertical. Otherwise, you would violate the Euler-Lagrange equation. So with this, I think that my time is pretty much over. I would like to thank you again and to send my greetings to Alessio, hoping that we can meet sooner or later in person again.
Okay, thank you, Rico. So I wonder if there are questions. So I don't see anyone in the chat, but does anyone want to ask a question? You can probably unmute yourself and ask, or you can write it in the chat and I can read it as you prefer. Okay, while we think about it, I have a question for Enrico, actually. I was thinking, so it's not the first time I see these results, right? So I had time to think. And I was wondering these. If you do the mean curvature flow we Dirichlet data on a convex domain, there is a classical result, I would say from the 80s, a result of Wisken, showing that you have exponential convergence toward the unique solution of the minimal surface equation. And it's somehow a classical result. I think Wisken also does that with Norman boundary condition even. So, I mean, you can do it in several ways. It's somehow simple because it's the gradient flow of a convex energy, right? So I was wondering, in this setting where we fix the outside of the cylinder, we fix this non-local boundary data. Okay, the minimization immediately, you see immediately this stickiness, right? So this thing. But then as I imagine this as a gradient flow, so I am doing time discretization, my sequence of minimization problems, I should see a sequence of sticky boundaries, right? So, which makes me think that probably the gradient flow would, in the gradient flow, you would have a sort of moving free boundary, sticky free boundary at the side of the cylinder, that maybe could be interesting study, I guess.
Yes. I think you're right. I mean, we didn't argue with the gradient flow, but yes, I mean, I agree. It's definitely interesting studying it. So our approach was stationary in a sense, mm-hmm. only based on integral contributions. But I agree that the link with the geometric flow surely deserves some more attention.
Okay.
I mean, also to me, one thing that deserves more attention is the link with the Allen-Kahn equation, right? So one thing that I'm not 100% sure how to understand is the influence of the stickiness phenomenon on the Allen-Kahn equation.
So, or somehow if you replace the fractional perimeter with the fractional Allen-Kahn energy,
yes,
if you see stickiness somehow.
Yes, but I don't know precisely to formalize it, right? Because it's a level set, so
okay.
Would be like a quantification on where the level set is located, and I'm not sure it's easy to spot because the level set is not going to be precisely the non-local minimal surface, right? So
right.
I'm not sure how to quantify the proximity of the level set with the minimal surface with respect to the parameter epsilon that is also playing a role.
I
agree. I mean, the two things maybe are related also in a sense, because also the motion by mean curvature is related to the Allen-Kahn equation. So probably there is a lot to investigate in the interplay between the three.
Yeah, that's the impression. Yeah, that's very interesting. Okay, so I'm not sure if there are other questions, but if there are not, yes.
Yeah.
Is there one? Yes.
Yeah, it's me. So Enrico, you have all these, very kind of very precise results on the boundary behavior, especially, I mean, if you combine what you said and also what Ovidio and Daniela did, but so what do you expect in higher dimension?
Yes, so we started the investigation in dimension 3. So there is a trivial answer that you can just put trivial data outside the cylinder and of course you get stickiness. In general, we have a recent paper with Serena and Ovidio in which we analyze a bit the situation in dimension 3. The fact is that in higher dimension, even the notion of stickiness is a little bit tricky because you can have stickiness in the sense that you have discontinuity, but you can also have stickiness in the sense that transversally you have a gradient in one direction or in the other. And so we provided some examples in dimension 3. In higher dimension is even more open, I would say. One thing that sooner or later I would like to do, but it's a little bit tedious, for instance, is even in dimension three or in any dimension, an example mm-hmm. of stickiness that is the generalization of the one in the slab. So for instance, you take a ball, you minimize in the vertical cylinder with some boundary data here, and you prove that you have stickiness in an n-dimensional ball. I mean, yeah. This is probably true, of course, one would expect it. But again, one has to construct a tailor-made barrier in higher dimension, which is not easily obtained by the two-dimensional case. So yes, I think that the higher dimensional case is very interesting, and we know a bit, but very little for the moment, I would say.
Okay, thank you.